Hello, my name is Chiyuma Elliott, and I'm Associate Professor of African American Studies and the Acting Director of the Arts Research Center here at UC Berkeley. It's a privilege to get to introduce our Poetry in the Senses Fellows tonight for this celebration of creative writing and reflection on coexistence. Before we begin, I want to offer a land acknowledgement. The Arts Research Center recognizes that UC Berkeley sits on the territory of the Chechenyo-speaking Ohlone people. We recognize that every member of the Berkeley community has benefited and continues to benefit from the use and occupation of this land since the institution's founding in 1868. This region continues to be of great importance to the Muwekma Ohlone tribe and other familial descendants of the sovereign Verona Band of Alameda County, who are flourishing members of the Berkeley and broader Bay Area communities today. Funding for the Poetry in the Senses initiative here at UC Berkeley comes from Engaging the Senses Foundation, and I'd like to give the Arts Research Center special thanks to the foundation and to Mona Abadir for her support for these established and emerging writers who we get to hear read tonight. Anastasia Lee, Gisselle Medina, Lindsay Choi, Vincente Perez, Ahmad Diab, Jesse Nathan, Maurya Kerr, and Damani Thomas. These writers have been workshopping together this semester and sharing creative work, research, discussion, and critique every other week. One thing that makes the Poetry in the Senses workshop unique is its diversity. Eight fellows are chosen, two in each category of UC Berkeley faculty, graduate and undergraduate students, and Bay Area community poets. The Poetry in the Senses fellows believe in the relevance and urgency of lyrical making and storytelling. And during their fellowship terms, they explore the role of the senses and the emotions in relation to the fellowship theme, which this year is coexistence. Here's the plan for tonight's reading. I'll introduce the featured poets, and then they'll read their poems. After that, we'll have a conversation about writing and coexistence. The ARC staff will be watching the chat, so please send us any questions that you'd like me to ask our poetry fellows. Now, I will introduce the poets in the order in which they'll read, and then I'll turn over the mic. Lindsay Choi is a poet and translator working between English, Korean, and Swedish. They are the author of Transverse, Future Poem 2021, as well as a chapbook, Matrices, Spect Books 2017. More of their work can be found in Omniverse, Asterix, Journal, and elsewhere, including a forthcoming sound piece for A Matter. They are a Kundamon Fellow and a PhD candidate in English Literature at UC Berkeley. Ahmad Diab is a Palestinian writer and academic. He is assistant professor of modern Arabic literature and cinema, 20th and 21st centuries at UC Berkeley. His work contemplates the relationship between displacement and representation. He received his BA from Damascus University. He was awarded a PhD from the Department of Middle Eastern and Islamic Studies at NYU. He is currently finishing his first academic book entitled Intimate Others, Representations of Arabs in the Palestinian Imaginary. He is also finishing his Arabic translation of After the Last Sky by Edward Said and compiling a volume of poetry provisionally titled Measures of Distance, which is an exciting development. Maurya Kerr is a Bay Area-based writer, educator, and artist. Maurya's poetry has been nominated for a Pushcart Prize and appears in or is forthcoming in multiple journals, including Inverted Syntax, Chestnut Review, Tupelo Quarterly, Little Somethings Press, and an anthology, The Future of Black, Afrofuturism, Black Comics, and Superhero Poetry. Much of her artistic work across disciplines is focused on Black and Brown people reclaiming their birthright to wonderment. Maurya was recently chosen by Jericho Brown as a runner-up in Southern Humanities Review's 2021 Auburn Witness Poetry Prize, and her first chapbook, Mutuality, will be published with Harbor Editions in 2022. Anastasia Lee is a poet, printmaker, and student cooperative member in her final year of a BA in Comparative Politics at UC Berkeley. Her first published poem appears in the 2021 Southeast Asian Student Coalition Anthology in honor of the 46th anniversary of the Southeast Asian diaspora. Her work concerns reconciliation, political, sacramental, or otherwise. Anastasia was born and raised in the Lake Chabot area of the East Bay among the Vietnamese Catholic community of the Oakland Diocese. She is the oldest of three daughters, and her favorite color is red. Gisselle Medina's identity consists of multitudes, a Latinx queer non-binary from Los Angeles. They are a poet, visual artist, and journalist in their final year as an undergraduate at the University of California, Berkeley. In Medina's scholarship, they investigate the history of literature and intertwine various methods and theories into literary and cultural analysis. In their poetry, Medina writes fiercely about their restless past and our collective world in hopes to inspire and transcend anyone willing to listen. Medina inspires to be an investigative reporter for the LA Times, a multi-published poet and founder of a nonprofit organization for mental health. This is only the beginning of their journey. Jesse Nathan's poems appear in the Paris Review, Kenyon Review, The Nation, Fence, The Yale Review, Harvard Review, and the American Poetry Review. His translations of Alfonsina Storni and Brenda Solis Fong in Mantis appear in Mantis and Poetry International. Nathan was born in Berkeley, where he lived until he was 10. He spent the second half of his childhood on a wheat farm in rural Kansas. Nathan moved to San Francisco after college, in part to take a position at McSweeney's. His work has been supported by the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation, the Ashbury Homeschool, Breadloaf, and the Community of Writers. He lives in Oakland and is a lecturer in the English department at UC Berkeley. Vincente Perez is a Black Mexican-American performance poet, scholar, and writer, working at the intersections of poetry, hip hop, and digital Black cultural praxis, with an interest in the ways that artists use narrative to resist dominant stories that attempt to erase, subjugate, or enact violence on marginalized communities. Their work centers Black and Latinx lived experience with a stylistic approach that samples and remixes hip hop and performance poetry into counter narratives. He's a PhD candidate in the Performance Studies program. Damani Thomas is a Black visual theorist, horror enthusiast, and writer from Oakland, California, Ohlone territory. Damani has received fellowships from The Watering Hole, Foglifter Literary Journal, and Bacchanal d'Afrique via Afro-Urban Society. When he's not writing, find him watching horror movie trailers, drinking smoothies, or reading YouTube spoilers for movies he has no attention span for. Damani's work has been published by the Auburn Avenue, the Anna Mary Journal of New Writing, Shade Literary Arts, and his poem Survival Tactics was recently shortlisted for the 2020 Penrose Poetry Prize. His current work obsesses over what it means to create intimacy under total surveillance. And now, I will hand the mic over to you poets, starting with Lindsay. Let the poems commence.
Thanks so much. That was really lovely. So I'll be reading firstly a short poem from my recently published first book, Transverse. And I'll be sharing my screen for that. This is called Plate, after Anna Mashavakis. Wine, flowers, revelry, to place in a wooden bowl, which epic poets are to drink water from, while lyric poets may enjoy wine and perhaps also flowers and revelry without regard for carnage or with heightened pleasure due to carnage. A particular vagueness entailed in kumquats, a precursor to grief, eggs in the nest of grief, which must also be placed in a wooden bowl to sun, like flower water, wine collected from a wooden floor, glass in its truest shadow, not a cup, nor a vase, nor a jug, but a lung and sorrow, a bouquet or palette of particular monochrome colors, heart steak, pearl onion, more air, more moors, to relinquish dance, fall prey to love in the forgetting that all liquid must be fetched in a wooden bowl from a river into which one can never step twice and find the same river or sameness, though in the forgetting I have fetched body in a bowl from the very stream I have often peered for divination, though I have become uncertain if it is the same river, if it ever has been lined with birches, if the body I have brought back, if it is a body, if it become the same body, if the song I have whispered to the river, if it is indeed a song, if the wooden bowl I have fetched for love or grief or lamentation is the bowl that will fulfill this act of love, if it is an act of love to braid song, braid body, braid river, range. And I read this poem at every reading because it helps me. The second part of, the next thing I'm going to read is from a working draft of a new manuscript, which is tentatively titled Heliotrope. And this material, or at least the portion that I'm about to read, is really new, and I'm excited to get to share it. Okay. 해와 하늘 빛이 문민은 서러워. 보리밭에 달 뜨면 애기 하나 먹고 꽃처럼 붉은 울물 밤새 울었다. 'Who can remember his past lives? Architecture, fashion, yes, even the weather, are in the interior of the collective, what the sensoria of organs, the feeling of sickness or health are inside the individual. That's Walter Benjamin from the Arcades Project. Enter the scene of the blue bull bellowing, the pillar of smoke. Scales grow over your eyes. Your limbs grow heavy with mercury. She appears to you to be of semi-synthetic substance. Your kidneys fill with fluid. You appear to you to be of semi-synthetic substance. Your manufacturer imparts the concept of your hand. It tips off the circuit. Your manufacturer appears to you to be of your own design. Scales grow between you and your measures. Your manufacturer is semi-translucent and full of fluid. She is held aloft in mercury. You appear to manifest another. Fish move among your jewels. You appear to manifest an other and its apprehension. Memory operates as if within you. Your manufacturer appears to you to be of your own self-same substance. Memory operates as if upon or becomes you. Your hands held aloft in mercury. Your concepts move among your jewels. You have exchanged much of your blood for lymph. Enter the pale bowl, bright smoke. Your hands held aloft in the self-same substance. Fish dart amidst your thighs. As though you could establish equivalence without measure or price. She is held aloft as if inscaled. Your hands fill with fluid, as if by love possessed. Your skin is dry and of itself same substance. When we investigate further, we find that all appears upside down. Fish move among your circuits. You emerge amidst your articulations. Scales operate as if within you. You have made yourself beautiful in vain. Your jewels appear to move. Your body is dry and appears to emit a low hum, as if by love possessed. You once appeared to be emitting a low light. Your skin is pebbled over like fruit. Your lips move as if within you. When caressed, your scales express a clear fluid. You are muddy and swollen with cold. Your manufacturer appears to you to be your own hand. You emerge garbed in your exchanges. Your manufacturer appears to you to operate as a semi-synthetic substance. In your book, all my parts have been written. You appear to move amongst the exterior of event. You hold the child aloft, as if of greater mass held aloft in smoke. It appears to emit a lunar hum. You appear to be an agent of synchrony. Its skin smells powdery and lactic. Your lips move as if among fish, as if of greater musculature aloft in smoke. Your color manufactures intercourse with the exterior of event. You appear to exchange position with your self-same substance. And there's more of that, but that's what I'll read for tonight. Thank you. And it's my pleasure to pass the reading on to...
Thank you, Lindsay. I think of these poems as splinters and shards. They are short in part because I feel breathless, but for the first time in a real long time, not too breathless to write. And that's thanks to Laurie and to my cohort here. Here goes. A redundancy. To live in one language, to live long enough to live in another. To remember things you lived in one, but now inscribe in the other. Traces left on the rim of the glass of memory. Now color your lips as you kiss your enemy. Topography. I was born by the river in a camp between two massacres. Change came on the cattle train that no longer runs, and dropped us there at a bend in history. a new address. On the seventh floor, I rested my bags and questioned the wind. Will this be home or an end? I checked the boxes, counted the books, tipped the movers, and once again did the math. A cardboard box has six faces. My life, 1,000 edges. I caught myself again, separating the two. I go out to the balcony, overlooking the fall, and laugh at the drama. A sunset, a shadow, and a murder of crows. A sunset in exile. A tree braids in a tent. A loud thrust. A pelican penetrates the placid pond. Crimson baby waves scatter all the way to the Holy Land. White thighs timestamp the circumference of the lake. Local dust scatters all the way to the wind's abode. The tribe of crows returns home to work on their masterpiece, splashed on the horizontal mural in the heart of downtown. A hologram of our savior at the corner returns to life at 7 p.m., looks down at the man caught between the artists and their canvas. Peals of laughter fill the sky all the way to our hills of time. Did he only die twice? He died tomorrow morning. He died this evening. I counted. I still count. Could I have held him through the night of the 11-hour difference? Was he alive in between? Was I alive in between? In the morning, when I open my eyes, I see him closing his forever, again. Why does he keep dying? New York. New York does to one what one does to an artichoke. She cooks you until maturity, then petal by petal, her teeth gnawing, clenching, grating, scalping, flaying, peeling, strips you until there's nothing left. She piles the violated remains of spring on a paper plate, dices up the heart, smothers it in sweat, and you are done. Thank you, and I'll hand it over to Maurya.
Great. Thanks, Ahmad. Okay, thank you. I'm Maurya. I'm one of the community fellows, along with Damani, who you'll hear at the end of the evening. And I'm going to read three poems. The first one is called To All Y'all. A little bit of my Moments of Levium, Texas coming out. Okay. To all y'all who ask me, what are you? I say this. Bitches, I am sea and sky, moon and sun, all the colors in one motherfucking bundle of bright. I am Parks and Davis and X, Mildred and Richard, my mama and my daddy, coffee, cream, and sugar, crepuscular. I'm the stuck-up, think-she-a-white-girl bitch in the morn on the right, and baby some latte later on the left at night. Yo, I'm a motherfucking celebration, standing on this bridge of liminality, all amalgam and alloy, bullseye and border, chafe and quarter, daddy's little secret. See, I'm the daughter, granddaughter, and great-great-motherfucking-great-granddaughter of an Africa chained and crated to America to be fucked and slaughtered by a great-great-fuck-no-he-ain't-great-grandfather. Interstitial, I'm the space between each grain of soil in the field, the tract of time between cracked and open cotton bowl, the toll and grime on the sole of masses boots, the semen on the see ma, look how pretty I am, dress of the girl gone to work her first day at the big house. Wait, you think Sally H. wanted Tommy J.?
Think she hemmed and hawed and had a choice to suck or not suck his pallid flaccid fuck of a dick? For your pasty old grandpapa, we girthed and rimmed with a one drop dark dripping down his drunk ass rear end. Impotence of segregation, I'm miscegenation. And I cusp and I cusp and I cusp and I cusp. Color me blues and black or white and wrong, but I'm a wheaten mutt, don't give a fuck. In fact, I'm mama of the mules, king of the curs, poet to all anti-pedigreed and pinto. I'm Africa and all 100 halves of the half-caste. I'm the biggest bitch of the bastard battalion, a magnate of amalgamation, and queen of the crossbreed ruling over the mongolization of this shithole nation. Know me, crown me, kowtow, kiss. And long live the ligers. Fuck yeah. Okay, that was poem number one. Okay, my next poem is called Top 15 Reasons White Men Prefer a Mulatto Girl in Bed. One, we're experts at cusping, rimming, and straddling the middle. Two, given that sex with them has always been our possible way out of the field, the whorehouse, the poorhouse, and the system, the stakes are high, hardline, and hot. We fuck for a release. Three, we're black, but not blackety black. Four, the tragedy of our so close but not quiteness of whiteness helps them feel better about their own upsets of almost there, just hold still. Five, who doesn't love an Oreo dipped, dunked, and munched down with milk? Six, we're good at fractions and grasping proportions, with centuries of experience measuring our blackness by drops of blood. A half caste here, quadroon over there, octoroon out back, hexadecaroon on the way. Seven, they're still trying to figure out how to do it a little more doggy, a little less missionary, and suspect we can help them strike the right balance. Eight, the same reasons they raped us on the plantation. Nine, because in flagrante delicto plus criminal Congress make them feel more Latinate and constitutional, thus closer to their founding fathers. 10, if blackity girls are a zero and white girls a five, we're the constant, incalculable, and transcendental pi, 3.14159. 11, mutts that we are, we're proficient at barking, biting, growling, panting, fetching, sitting, staying, laying down, and playing dead. But when they command us to come, sometimes we do, sometimes we don't. 12, fucking us allows them to participate in bigot pornography without having to snap a photo of the post-lynch picnic lunch. And having strung up most of the competition, they can pretend to be well hung. 13, they love the gush of freedom, air flowing through hair, and wind on their skin of riding a pinto bareback. 14. When we come, we emit an aroma of chocolate and vanilla that reminds them of that childhood day they discovered Dairy Queen sold a soft serve swirl. 15. What an energy efficient way to express anti-blackness. It's so much easier and cooler to lay in white sheets than to wear them. Okay, my last poem is called Venge, and I'm reading this today because today would have been my grandmother's 98th birthday. She died a few years ago. And in my family history, this is her birth story. So again, it's entitled Venge. The man hits you, throws you, pins you. So you pray to mother, to father, to the land you never knew, but that land knows a tongue you do not speak and your plaint lays unheard. This is how the fastened loosen. So you pray to the not father, not mother nor father, other land. This one here beneath the dirt floor, beneath the creaked bed, beneath you, beneath his hand, the man who is still under God. This land you know not by choice, but by force, but still, till, sweat, love. This bare-bone, unmuled land that God above you and you beneath the man God help you will never hold your beautiful bones. Your bones are meant for more, for some kind of glory. This you know. Minutes later, it's done. The man stands. The man walks to the door. The man opens the door. The man leaves. The door slams. The man has left. This is how the loosened sharpen. Behold the scythe, how it cuts. You stay still, open door, shut door, walk out a ways beneath this God-watched land, sit down, lay down, wait. You lose count of birds flown by, the times you swallow, blink, lick your lips. By dusk, you've decided. Your husband doesn't ask why you're lying beneath the sun in this mewless land, swallowing, blinking, licking your lips. He knows, waits. You rise, walk toward. Normally you lay together on the creaked bed beneath God and sky when he comes home weary bone, but tonight you both stand in the dirt floor room, quiet, dark. This is how the sharpened glisten. It is easy enough to find the man, kill the man. You and your husband bury the man sour bone deep beneath the land, beneath your goddamn glory body, beholding heaven beneath God. The smell of blood like newly slaked, late summer soil, like copper, like shine. Behold the scythe, how it reaps beneath God beheld. This is how the glistened fasten, how black steadfast, how a woman withstands. Plow the dead, harrow the fallow, till the bloody, sow. Then wait, bone, wait. Thank you. I'm going to pass it on to Anastasia.
Thank you so much, Maurya. Hi, everyone. I'm going to be starting with a poem titled Joy Stretches for Sunlight. In a garden, the tumult of history dims so that grass might grow, so that unscathed antonyms might die by sunlight. What am I healing for? What kind of music does my body make? What would happen if, where would I be if I wasn't here? This second poem is the only prose poem of my reading. It's titled Dharma Supply Store. I wrote it earlier in the year, before this fellowship, but I wanted to revisit it here. Dharma Supply Store. I wonder what they wanted from this place. To think they'd be growing old in a country that hasn't changed, to see their children start their lives in a society that violently denies any racialized person the space to be fully human in the way white people get to be on this stolen, devastated land. I wonder about their longings, what they left behind. I sit here with what they brought, a thesaurus, names of flowers, needle and thread, love of learning, ocean swimming, a bleach-dyed denim jacket. When we enter, are we prepared to never leave? In this moment, I hold laughter and dashed plans for hands that healed and held their love's soft smiles and secrets, smoky echoes wavering into this long night. This next one is titled Where Homeowners Take Their Dogs to Shit. A pyre alive with rain refrains the noise complaint of your joy, your umbrella collapse of a laugh. That night, each sharp oak leaf did us a favor. And though the rain takes your heat, cold is but the frontier between bodies. What can you do with wet kindling but watch it deny light, refract ash, and make you wonder how it always had to be this way? I have two more poems. I think I am very notorious in this fellowship for writing short poems. So that's why I think quite a few. This one is titled Waste Audit. I wear secondhand to feel like I have a history here. As I drag columns of dread under my dead woman's shoes, she says money is fake. Whereas all of this, gesturing at the clamshell container, an empty oat milk Tetra Pak, the takeout box I couldn't recycle, can last past the collapse of our society. This final poem is titled Crash Past. It was the first poem I wrote for this fellowship. I haven't read it in a long time, if 4 months is a long time. Crash past. A crow hovers in anticipation of the asphalt, an irritable wonder at the neon belly of the earth. Vines perpetuate their memory on newborn stones, still responsive to a waning sky shocked red. Dying evergreens don't blink when it rains. Thank you all. Gisselle, I hand it to you.
Thank you so much, Anastasia. Hi, everyone. My name is Gisselle Medina. I just want to say thank you so much for joining us tonight for a poetry reading. I'm very honored for the opportunity to read some of my work on this platform alongside some incredible artists. I'll begin by giving some context as to what I've been working on throughout this past semester, and then I'll get to it. Recently, I've been trying to look at the poems I wrote when I was a heartbroken teenager. I started writing poetry in high school, and these poems consist of a mixture of teenage angst with a lot of chaotic feelings. Thinking about the theme of coexistence, I struggled with trying to write things that can embody how I feel because I'm not really sure of those feelings. And it's been hard to mature my voice in my poetry, to not write like that same angsty, heartbroken teenager that I used to be. And that's when I realized that like I needed to take my first step is to rewrite everything by revisiting the past pain and like trying to feel and edit and define everything now that I've had some space from those immediate burning feelings. To me, coexistence is an act of triumph. It's to create yourself out of nothing. It's a choice to coexist in a society that does not embrace difference. To coexist with coexistence is difficult, and this is my attempt to both go for and against the theme. So my first poem is called Lost in Translation. I was born among promised land, thrown toward optimistic opportunity, secure shriveled life for myself. Name borrowed after powerful women cannot escape the expectation. Forced to smile to make others feel comfortable, sit up straight, legs crossed to mask my boyish talent, fully chew like a carnivore, hunter of prey, ethnicity borrowed from my ancestors, cannot escape expectations, composition of European and indigenous American, or mestizo for short. My blood does not embody me. Tainted with gentrification, bleached, stained, whitewashed skin, paper thin, bare-boned body, mommies disappointed of my Spanish, because I translate very different. Es difícil identificarme como latino cuando suena como si estoy servía tratando tan duro de pronunciar mi propio idioma. Mommy sacrificed her heart to get me here. Vanished a city called home, cleaned houses owned by television perfect families, nurtured children that she wished was her own. She would remind me with the belt, a whistle in the wind, howl with gnashed teeth, hopeful for the sting. My next poem is untitled. Bookshelves sit in the ebbs and flows of a library, packed in the corners. Loose leaf pages with scribbled markings, bound yet beaten spines with rough edges, detailing words brought by fragile humans, elements of fantastical fabrication within veracity. Gatsby is stacked lazily beside a heap of letters by Hamilton. Marx's manifesto clashes next to Rana Peikoff's parallels. Dickinson laughs at Whitman's idealized America. True Grit, and do androids dream electric sheep, sit together in the same time period. Nothing can keep our beloved stories apart. But what about the categorization of books that reflect invisible power structures and hidden hierarchies? The road ahead practically paved the way for how our societies choose to fail or succeed, while the life of the Admiral Christopher Columbus erased a history of Black America. How could we reorganize and reevaluate a system that forces coexistence on those who are suffering in a society that doesn't want to address the real issues found within our communities? Maybe we should choose to not coexist. My final poem is titled kind of like how a playwright would introduce a scene in a play. And so it's in brackets and it begins, "Begin sequence of the eternal dream." We dance among flickering neon lights, like an ongoing translucent flame, visible, interchanging. We laugh as we stumble, catch each other in hand, our lips press, synchronous, the air magnetic. This is the beginning of love blooming. We jolt awake, out of breath, ingrained, curse the universe, our circumstances. We greet next in an awkward hug. I can feel you leaving me, not physically, at least not yet. Your voice makes me ravenous for the night. Why are we letting this queer love die? Is it because you are afraid of discovering that we exist? Thank you, and I will pass it to Jesse Nathan.
Thank you. Everybody, thank you, Gisselle. It's a pleasure to be here with you all, and I'm very grateful to the Arts Research Center and Chai and Lori and my wonderful colleagues, fellows. I'm going to read a poem tonight that comes out of my part of my childhood growing up in near the Geographic Center of the United States, Kansas. I was trying to think what my poems have to say about coexistence, what my work means in that light. And I think in some ways I'm maybe often writing about the collapse of coexistence, but the hope for endurance. I think the only thing I'll say about this poem before I read it, it imagines a farmer's son. Many of the friends I had there were farm families. A farmer's son who's bringing in the last harvest before he heads off to graduate school, to law school, a sort of departure poem. And local knowledge that might be of use, the word anhydrous, some of you might be familiar with it. It's a kind of pesticide. This is called "What Jason Said." Yesterday, it seemed here to Galva was on fire. Velveteen ash made the sunset an astonishing alibi. Goodbyes are such blind spots. I'm tired. The horse-headed oil pump nods up and down. Summer isn't finished beating the hell from us. Bindweed in the ditches creeping into fields. Did you know our ancestors brought it unwitting in their wheat seed from the old country? Red winter wheat. A horde of gnats forms a singing tower. There's a story there too, if you can read it. I read the road, and the roads are visions of liquid in the dog days. Streaks of jets stack and fade. When the green header of the John Deere met the metal cradle of the wheat truck, it made a call like a hawk dying. In a horn, the gold burst forth, half the field's worth spilled in the stubble, and Dad fuming to the house. His mud clumps a trail upstairs. I hear him now flop down. Fox News. I dreamt last night I had a snout. I was one in a pack of raccoons. Purple diamonds for eyes. We zombie walk long driveways and the ruts of ethnic lanes and get nailed by tractor trailers or hail. Did you know there's an ailment of the wheat known as straw breaker? I find bindweed terribly pretty, that pearly cup, that half dollar cloud, but its roots unbridle stringy lightning, a deep choking rhizome. I'm unstrung and I'm rake whacked. In 2 weeks, it's away to law school. I'm missing the whiff of anhydrous already. Ha, I trade this for Socrates, certiorari, habeas corpus, contortion by torts. I want to read one other piece tonight, a little song for a very hot day. A lot of these farms had, they still have propane tanks, giant tanks. You know, they're sort of self-sufficient in their, or they want to be. There are wells on the property often. They aren't served by garbage pickup. There are incinerators on many of these farms and their own propane tanks. So they can be pretty isolated places. There are more and more hot days there, hotter and hotter days. A vireo is a little greenish songbird. And this is a poem called Straw Refrain. Young gray cat puddled under the boxwood, only the eyes alert, oppressed to dirt. That hiss, the hiss of the grasses hissing. What should? Blank road shimmers. On days like this, my mind, you hardly seem to be on days like these. No, see that sidelong silver drum? The hiss is a sigh of that propane tank. 2 o'clock, you can smell it. Don't breathe that sigh. The creek's gone dry. Summer is wide as this wildered sky, days like this. My mind, you hardly seem to be. Straw frail, no breeze. You had a theory that the birds would silence on a day like this. But the mocker's keenness and the kingbird and the vireos commence to warble on as heat bears down a day like this, my mind. You hardly seem to be. You road, you creek. Thanks very much. And it's a thrill to pass the baton to my colleague, Vincente Perez.
Wow, thank you, Jesse and everyone else for this time. I'm gonna start off with a poem a long time ago. All this work that I've been engaging with the Poetry and the Census Fellows, I've just kind of been trying to work on this manuscript called Narrating Otherwise, where I'm trying to write outside of the confines of whiteness. A long time ago, a Spaniard walked up to me and told me he was looking for gold. I couldn't find the right words to say, so he put his own tongue in my mouth. A little while after that, a rancher walked up to me and said, "This is American now." I looked up at my feet and the soil, and I uprooted. Years before, a man looked at me, decided I needed some deadly jewelry, made me play a terrifying dirge. I became a queer instrument, only played by the wind. Now I got this pain in my neck. It won't go away. It's like it doesn't know how to hold this head up high. My mother doubled over, gave birth, named me identity crisis. She knew I could bear the burden of history on my head. Time makes my body feel unproductive. I haven't used it quite like I'm supposed to. They say there's this ringworm going around, protect your neck. I've stuck mine out so many times, its noose neck inflamed. They lynched field workers, black and brown. These hands still ain't good enough. This back only useful for production. Joints have nostalgia, genes coated with trauma. I keep bruising black and brown. Bleach makes my stomach hurt. They are trying to erase me. Pure disinfecting politics make me germ. Minority microorganism leads simple life, can't understand modernity. With religion equal parts science and story, they gave my home a Christian baptism, new name and all. Holy water formed an oceanic deluge, beating back souls speaking from shoals, each voice building the peak of the hourglass. Now my voice, my throat is a sandbox. Veins carry blood that ain't mine. I live off borrowed time, neck shackled with expectations, but I can say I survived. For many, a rally cry, life lived and fought for, a declaration of a path taken, then conquered. But there are many kinds of death. Imagine a life defined only by struggle, never an ebb and flow, only hanging on. Time defines man. I am that I am, time and time again. A long time ago, a man walked up to me and handed me a funny smelling blanket with a stare that sent shivers down my back. I could feel the sickness then, and ever since my memory's been cursed. That's all the history I can remember right now. This next poem is getting published actually in January next year by River and South Review. It's a neighborhood seance. My friends were fist fights. We broke each other down to withstand what was ahead. We ate and spat prophecies misinterpreted as code switching, ciphered with streetlight hymns and instrumental neighborhood watch. Boys playing monitor the cars. It's fun to figure out if your block is being circled. A seance built my home, so we protect it. Graffitied names form pinnacles bonded through ritualistic joy, woven through fear. We stand here, roll the dice, say each homie's name twice, hoping no other noise circles back around. This next poem, I'm gonna share my screen and show you a little bit of some of the different work I'm trying to do. Let's see if I can zoom in so folks can see it. This is Quantum. One, time starts and people grow undisturbed until history begins. Civilizations are rendered relics, and though they denounce magic, these people learn to control time. Two, with the clock started, these people trust that their God made the world in 7 days, decided to treat new lands like the world God made, never called it blasphemy, only destiny manifested through divine right. Three, God made Eve via Adam's rib. As these people blossom, they baptize with blood and flesh every chance they could. It's better to give than to receive. Violence begets violence. The birth of freedom must be earned here. Four, stories became stored in words, marooned, puzzled pieces being put together feels like 52 card pickup. Was I king or queen when I was jacked? Five, added up, Poker faces greet me. House wins again. Jokers are treated like aces up sleeves. House rules our domain. We remain hidden in the plane. Cash out or get cashed in. 6. The story continues to be written in reverse. Correction fluid at the ready. With stopgap in stops, America writes for itself. Stop. This is America. This is her story. History. This is America. This is history. This is a story. Time is history. America erases history. This is her story. Mercy me. Is America sorry? And I'll read one last poem. This poem is titled Whiteness, and it is after Langston Hughes' poem, White Man. It's my first attempt at an after poem. Langston Hughes is a wonderful poet, and I had to think alongside him, and this poem came out of that process. Of course I recognize you, your whiteness. I'm a nigga. You self-made and work for yourself, do charity, and we work for you. You stay comfortable in a gated community, and your properties are subsidized, and your wealth stay in the family. You enjoy Mexico and take Guam. Whiteness, whiteness. Let hip hop do it and you appropriate it and make the money. You're the real creative whiteness. You can copy anything. But now I hear you hate your name, whiteness. I hear it's something new and made up. Heidegger wrote out your being. Isn't this true, whiteness? Hasn't fascism called you home? Isn't your name hidden in the margins of a library of mirrors called canon? Isn't your name spelled A-N-N-I-H-I-L-A-T-I-O-N? Must you always kill whiteness? Huh? Thank you. I'm proud and honored to introduce you all to our last reader, but definitely not the least. This man's amazing and incredible. I'm happy to announce Damani.
Thank you. I'm really excited to go after Vincente and have people texting me about one of your poems right now. So you should be excited. Yeah, so I'm one of the community fellows, as was mentioned earlier, and I'm currently working on a chapbook around like surveillance and intimacy. But what I spent this like first semester really trying to work through is that just like writing got like kind of boring for me, or just like writing normally. And so I spent a lot of time like experimenting to see if that would kind of like re-trigger that. So I'm going to share my screen. Okay, so this, I have two poems for you. This first poem is titled Intro to Chemistry. So for those of you that hate chemistry, I'm sorry. So Intro to Chemistry. Oxygen is O, carbon is C, hydrogen is H, equals it is. When a hydrant of water is pumped through a fire hose at a choir of unsuspecting obsidian, it is just. When muriatic acid is dumped into a public pool of carbon-oxygen co-mingling, it is socially acceptable. Because there is a C present, it is carbon on carbon crime. A party of oxygen disappears carbon and scientists say Earth is saved. When governments drone intimacy without consent, it is in the name of American safety. American safety is breaking and entering in Hampton Panther shot and sleep. Util until Jeff Bezos or the FBI hijacks the concept. Equal equals is. U is uranium. P is phosphorus. B is boron. S is sulfur. F is fluorine. FR is francium, TH is thorium. For the purposes of this class, we'll define equilibrium as a point where cause and effect sustains itself, an endless loop. Example, 1,000 oxygen for one carbon. One female oxygen hears a whistle and scientists create new methods to muffle sound. Carbon says it is tired of disappearing and oxygen pretends not to see it. Carbon shows the world proof and oxygen shows the world military force. Most declarations in America are either volatile or fragile. Example, with freedom of speech, I save the poor people from themselves because I pay taxes, because I bear arms, because I pledge allegiance. Okay, that's my first poem. And this last one, I'm just gonna keep sharing my screen. Again, just playing around with this idea of just doing like weird stuff in poetry. So this poem is titled, Let's Play a Game Called The Narrator Pitches Poem Idea to Reader. Okay, so the poem starts with manifest destiny in reverse, like graves unbury themselves. The ghost lady catwalks home and everything her dress ruffles chooses a new name. Except lilies, carnations, and roses still call themselves funeral flowers, because what else do they know? I mean, I guess they know love, but last time I asked the flower community what love meant, they said, I don't know what love is, but I want it to mean more than seasonal. Speaking of, dirt calls itself black, says I've always wanted to be a part of diaspora, and I can't prove it, but I feel like all of our dirt is actually some creature decomposed. Imagine this, the cemetery becomes a daycare. The skeletons find clothes and aspirin waiting. For a low price of half a single mother's paycheck, the skeletons can infant 5 days a week. For one image, I think our flag should unstitch, and every star gained through occupation dims like a nightlight running out of battery. Do you like that? What if even Lady Liberty dismantled and repoed back overseas? Tangent. How would you feel if I called Manifest Destiny Lady a more American name? Something that makes tongue an island and calls it mine. Something that marshmallows in the mouth. Ah, how do you feel about me verbing marshmallow when I really mean the subject takes up space? Would you prefer if I just said things explicitly? Let's play a game called, is the poem about a grand concept actually about the narrator? In the game, you, the audience, are given words and are supposed to figure out the obsession. Example, I give you metaphors and you ask, why does the narrator want to reverse time so badly? And if this is a two-subject poem, like we were told, then why is the narrator speaking for us? What is the narrator's relationship to the undead or the dead or the act of dying? Does the narrator see poetry as an extension of alchemy? There's been mentions of women, the matriarchy this poem summons, but no men. What is the narrator's relationship to men? Okay, okay, enough about the narrator. How about more imagery? How about in one scene, Atlantis emerges from the ocean like a lifeguard from Baywatch. Water drifts off architecture in a sex montage. Or what if we kept the scene focused? I'm thinking the inverse of prisons would be interesting, or maybe an inverse election. The president princess waves his way out of the white building. Each step raises tile floor like dandelion furs floating from center. Signatures uncursive into snakes. Promises combust into carbon. War stop and politicians peel to the rind. We find they are filled with nothing. Soldiers with no jobs become police officers with no jobs. With no country to justify their violence, ballots dissolve like chalk medicine, emerge as paper cranes or preschool art project. In the final scene, a child smiles and erases the line between marriage and divorce. So do you like that poem? How about after some revisions? Any suggestions? Now? 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 How about now? And I'll pass it back over to our wonderful introductorist. I don't know if that's a word. To Chai.
It is now. It is now, Damani. I want to play a game called Finish the Poem Title. let's play a game called Blank. I'm going to maybe ask y'all that later. So just mull on that. But poets, thank you for sharing your work. I am so grateful. For the creative risks that you take and also for the kindness you show one another. Folks in the audience, there's just been all kinds of love, you know, going on the chat, you know, in between the fellows during the readings. It's just, it's really beautiful to watch. All right, so I want to kick off the Q&A with questions for Maurya and Vincente. So here's the first pair of questions. So earlier this term, both of you co-facilitated live stream conversations with some really famous guest poets here at the Arts Research Center. So here's the sort of linked questions. Is it easier to be the featured reader or the interviewer? And how did you choose which poems to share with the audience tonight? Maybe whichever one of the two of you wants to jump in first.
You want to go, Vincente?
Yeah, sure, I can do that. It is definitely easier, I feel, to read.
Yes.
Because when you're in the room with absolute greats, you don't even feel like you will ever be able to say the right thing, let alone be able to give something to the space, because these folks in this room do such incredible work that you spend a lot of time just like, how can I include the audience in a way that is going to just add more to the scene? It's almost like you don't want to speak because they're doing so much great work just amongst themselves. And I think to the second part of the question, I wanted to try to talk through the work of my manuscript narrating otherwise, because it speaks directly to the theme for the fellowship, which is coexistence. This is a theme that I struggle with. I do think that there are things in the world that should be existed with alongside, but my idea of coexistence as a Black and brown person, you know, as a light-skinned person and all these different things is very different than the idea of coexistence that has been forced onto me in American society, for example. And so I like to think about narrating otherwise in my poems as alternative ways to think of coexistence, to think about what happens if you think about Black anti-Blackness and Black community, what does things like coexistence do to us? And that's what helped me think about some of these poems. And I kind of realized there were lots of things that I didn't want to exist with. And so that was where a lot of the poems I chose, that was what was kind of the inspiration for them.
I love that. Maurya, how about you? Where are you on this?
Yeah, so much easier to be the reader. Like, it was pretty stressful. I mean, I know we didn't look stressed, but I think we were both stressed in our own ways. And it's also sort of what Vincente was saying, like feeling like, why am I here a little bit? Like there's such brilliance going on, and like trying to ask a question that might be somewhat intelligent. Also not really being able to enjoy them fully, because I'm like getting ready to ask a good question. And I sort of mentioned this to the cohort after talking to Ross and Camille, but just being really aware of the different kinds of intelligences that there are and ways of expressing that. And Camille and Ross are so different in how they sort of express their ideas. And I feel like much more akin to Ross's, like, there's more like swooping, and Camille is such a like brilliant scholar that was very much like, this is the way things are, which is like something I wish I had in my arsenal, but that's not sort of my intellectual background. It was great to read tonight. I also just love getting more practice reading, because I think it's a skill that we all will need. In terms of what poems I read, all of them, the three poems I read are from my upcoming soon to be published chapbook, which I'm still processing that excitement. And to all y'all, the first poem I read, I'm trying to read poems that feel like they challenge me and how I present myself. Venge, the last poem I've read at a lot of readings, and I just love reading it. Like, I feel like there's some poems that have this sort of natural velocity and rhythm that's really enjoyable for me to read. And then the top 15 reasons poem I wanted to read, I haven't read that before. I'm always trying to read new poems aloud. And it's also really vulnerable. And I wanted to try to do that in a public space. So, yeah.
Again, risks, bravery. That reminds me of something that you said, Lindsay, about I read this poem at every reading because it helps me, right? Like there's some mm-hmm. of these poems that just, that help us, that move us through. So an audience member, Dakota, sent a question, and I'm going to pose this one for Lindsay and Jesse. So here's what Dakota wants to know. Okay, they write, cliche question, sure, but for anyone who wants to answer, what's an immediate source of inspiration? Okay, so Lindsay and Jesse, your immediate source of inspiration.
You want to take this first, Jesse? Or how should we?
I was hoping you might.
It's going to be a polite off. You're going to just continue to defer to one another for like a really long time.
Well, I would say on the one hand, there's sort of no shortage of inspiration, living, just being alive. And the problem is more just finding the time to sort of act on or explore those inspirations or leap off from them. On the other hand, my 20-month-old daughter is probably at the center of inspiration these days. For me, her learning from her, the sort of little lessons that she has and discoveries that she's making. I think, and of course, all the books, you know, that are floating around. That's not the most coherent answer, but I think that's a start as far as what's immediate inspiration. Everything, I don't know, not helpful probably.
Well, the children's books, right? Like the things that are in the air, like this. Really, I don't know. I'm so curious to see what happens. You know, what happens in the poems, because you're sort of revisiting.
I mean, the lesson the other day, I realized watching her that you can dance anytime. You know, she just starts dancing whenever she hears, you know, any or something outside, that the music, some music inside, things like that. Yeah, are manna for these times that we're in.
Lindsay, how about you? Inspiration.
I was thinking about this, and I guess the most, so this is going to sound circuitous, but I'm a very lazy person, and I don't like to do things unless it's going to help me in some way. That actually is not true. I can't do anything unless I know why I'm doing it. And that tends to be what ends up going into my writing process. I'm very much not the kind of person that writes every day, or even writes every month. And it's partially so a lot of the work that I do ends up trying to preserve the movement and impetus behind a line of questioning. My work, I want generally when I write to keep a question alive so that it can continue doing the thinking, even when I walk away from it. A lot of what ends up happening then is, I guess, feels like unspontaneous in a way. So that's what makes it a little difficult to like answer the question of inspiration, specifically. But it is like generally like the process involves like trying to mediate the impulses towards control and intuition, and trying to get these things to align in such a way that something unpredictable can still happen. Sorry, I totally swerved around that, but
that's so beautiful, right? Like, because that's the honest answer. The honest answer is sometimes like it's a little circuitous and it's a little bit messy, and now I want to ask everybody to tell a lie about yourself. and then immediately correct it. I do that. Let me throw a question. Anastasia and Gisselle, let me throw a question your way. So here's something folks want to know. What has it meant to be in conversation with 7 new colleagues this semester? How has it affected you or the work? Anastasia, would you be willing to answer that one first?
I remember writing in my application for this fellowship a year ago during finals week that I wanted to do this and wanted this because I don't think I can write without like a community that also follows the call to love or something like that. Like that's what I wrote, I think. And I found that, and I'm I feel very something along the lines of like colors and borders and boundaries and lines make less sense, and I find myself often as I have throughout my life unraveling into the space of speechlessness, but I still show up to our meetings and try to share, and I can manage that sometimes, and I think that's what it's meant to me, and I'm very lucky for that exact reason.
Gisselle, how about you? In conversation with these new folks.
There's so many feelings that I have. I remember also doing the application and just being like, I want a tight-knit group of writers to be around and just like write. And being in that space with everyone here every 2 weeks and just like writing and sharing work and just being super intimate with each other in that sense, I just think it's incredible. I'm also very new, I feel like, to sharing my work, to even publishing. I'm very new to everything. And so I feel like just, I'm so inspired by every single poet, and I'm so lucky to be able to be there and just listen. And yeah, I don't know. It's just, it's great. It's a great feeling. Also intimidating, but amazing.
I was really moved when you were introducing your poems and you were talking about the messiness of feelings. Actually, I think that's one of the things that I look for in poems. Like when I try to think about like, what are the poems that actually really engage me as a reader, like push me as a writer? It's the ones when the speaker has interesting feelings. And so I just want to just appreciate the fact that like you leaned into that and you're like, I have all these earlier poems that the feelings are really messy and I want to like go back.
Thank you so much.
But just what you're saying about like being in conversation, you know, like working with these with these colleagues and like exploring feelings in this way, I feel like it's brave, right? And it's at least for me, right? It feels like this is the fundamental part of what we're doing. I'm getting a note here, and we've got a question for you, and I'm not seeing it. Sorry, this is a small technical glitch happening. So I'm going to circle back. Oh, here we go. Got it. So from the chat, you mentioned that here's from the audience. You mentioned that you faced earlier trauma and childhood angst. How do you feel now that you've pushed through those feelings again in the context of coexistence? And was it healing?
Oh my gosh.
That's an amazing question.
where do I begin with that? I don't know how to answer this. I just feel like revisiting everything, like how I was saying in the beginning, has been very strange for me. But also like healing in a sense, and just like being like, oh wow, I actually went through everything that I went through, and here I am, and I've created a life for myself, and I have people that are here to support me, and it's just, I'm very lucky to be here. Like, I'm very thankful. And just writing poems now, like thinking about coexistence. You know, I remember like submitting poetry for the application, and I think all of my poems that I submitted were about coexistence, or like going for that. And I'm just like, well, after I submitted, I was like, well, I don't necessarily feel that all the time though, but does that mean I won't get in if I'm on it, if I'm honest about it? I don't know. But I'm glad that I'm able to like explore what coexistence means to me, and it's okay to not feel like I have to coexist with the world all the time. You know, I think that's just so important. Yeah.
I'm going to pivot, Ahmed and Damani. So question for you too. How has the pandemic changed your writing or your writing practice? And what have you learned about yourselves as writers during this time?
It's a good question.
I saved it for you.
Do you have any thoughts, co-answerer?
If y'all are drawing a blank, you can tell a lie about yourself. Actually, that would be good. Damani, tell me a lie about yourself.
I have 20 siblings who are all named Ashley.
All right, somebody else tell me a lie about Damani.
His birthday is not today.
Excellent. Okay, folks, pandemic, you writing, what happened? Inquiring Minds wants to know. I mean, you've had these amazing different things happen. I mean, I know this because I got to, you know, show up. I got to crash the first of the workshops for just a little bit and heard you talking about your writing and heard some of your, you know, your poems at the poem at the very beginning. And, you know, different energy right now, even with some of the same poems, like they're, I can hear specific differences. So something went on. What's going on? What's been going on? What have you noticed about yourselves as writers?
Yeah, so I'll say that I guess when the kind of shelter in place first happened, like last year, I mean, just like incredibly just like unfortunate, just like the timing of it and just like the mismanagement of that. But it did force me to just like sit my ass down and just like all the stuff I said that I wanted to write and parse through, like I had time to do so because it was like dangerous not to do so. And so like that's how I ended up like thinking about like surveillance and intimacy. I think on the flip side of that is I got to the point, like I mentioned this earlier, of like writing started feeling like boring. So now I'm trying to figure out how to keep myself interested and keep the work meaningful. So I guess it just like layered my questions. Yeah, I'll say that's my answer.
For me, it heightened a sense of feeling jet lagged the whole time because I check the news for different times of the world. I'm in touch with other people across the world on different sort of messaging platforms. So the structure that existed in my physical world that punctuated my day was all of a sudden gone. And so I felt freer to stay up later than I necessarily would have. And it's just exasperated an older sense of like stationary jet lag, if that's a thing. And in that sense, it wasn't necessarily very sort of productive in terms of writing. It was productive experientially, and it was, you know, a solid. It allowed me to have this experience of the life of the mind and a solitary existence, and it allowed me to actually fall in love with the Bay Area for the first time, because I managed to go on so many hikes and see. Sort of take in the natural beauty in a way that I haven't had the chance to before. So I was able to both be in touch with the topography here, with nature here, and with myself in a way that, you know, I really don't remember having since I was a child. So to the extent that that's sort of helpful with my writing, it. That's one of the changes that happened to me during the pandemic.
Thank you for sharing that. I feel like one of the most important things that we do as writers is be really honest about, you know, the times when we're not writing. So it sort of normalizes that actually it's, that's part of what this is. That's part of what this is about. Vincente, I'm seeing a hand up. Oh my gosh, it feels like a class. Just jump in, folks. It's your workshop.
I'm sorry. I was just thinking about this question of sheltering in place, isolation, and our like writing process. So I think what surprised me was that a lot of people around me were telling me that they were feeling isolated because of the shelter in place, but I'm a father. And so I was now feeling like I never again was going to have time to myself. And so for me, the writing process, I wanted to be in a fellowship like this because I wanted to be back around writers, because I was finding that we were being so like shoved into our homes and forced not to like speak to each other. And that turned into not being honest with each other about what we were going through. And so a lot of my time and my writing process changed because I had to start finding new ways to be alone or to deal with the, you know, quarantine, the shelter in places, and trying to find community in a world that was more dangerous in the sense that interacting meant something different for us. And so the twins have been having a great time because of the pandemic and been enjoying being at home and playing all the time. But it also meant it was really hard to find time to write alone. And it became a lot of the isolating parts of writing became even harder because it was hard to figure out how I felt, because a lot of the time, as Damani, I feel was kind of expressing like this idea of surveillance and intimacy. Like that's what became like so apparent in my life all the time. It was like we're having these conversations around like not being seen, not touching, not being around. And so that was like causing me to feel like I needed to do a lot of work, but also I was in a home with children and it was harder to do that work. And I was expected to work instead of to sit my ass down and think about my life. I was, you know, working to live. And so that's how it impacted me.
Word. Yeah.
So can we give a shout out to Damani's birthday? Hello.
Yeah, actually, okay. We totally have to. And actually from the audience, there's a shout out for your birthday and also a question for you, Damani. Here goes. Happy birthday. Also, during the intro to chemistry, it made me wonder, is there a hope involved with getting the message across to a new audience, or is it just where your interests lay? So a really, really tough birthday question.
Thank you. And The first part of that question was, is there a hope in getting the message evolved in across to a new audience?
Yeah.
I mean, honestly, I'm sure there is somewhere, but I think like above that on the, like above that interest is, so I come from like a slam background, and what I notice a lot is that like people will tune out certain subjects if like A, there's a lot of that subject in the slam, or B, it's just like something people are talking about a lot. And so I think my interest here was to, well, like my little cousin is like was working with like molecules and like the periodic table, but it was to make sure like people didn't tune out that subject. Yeah.
Can I ask a question actually about that, also about that poem? Formally, what were your catalysts? In the middle of that poem, I was just like, is he talking to Van Jordan's poem, The Flasher versus Time? Is that it? Is something about, I'm like, huh, this is super interesting because it's very cinematic in a lot of the ways that Jordan's poems are cinematic. I don't know if that was like, where did that form? Where did that approach come from? Or was it magic?
Yeah, magic. And again, just like, because I'm so removed from like school, I mean, like not a lot removed, but like certain subjects like earth science or whatever, like watching my like 10-year-old cousin look at a periodic table and just have confusion about that reminded me that like those connections were possible. And just the way that like a lot of poets do that like sleight of hand thing where it's like, I'm talking about noodles, but I'm actually not talking about noodles.
Yeah.
It's just black birthday boy magic, right?
That's good name. I love it because sometimes that's the answer, right? Like it seems like it came from the ether. It came from the ancestors. It came from, you know, fill in the blank. Oh gosh, we are almost out of time, folks. So here's what I'm hoping. I'm hoping that somebody will just share some memory or a moment from workshop that stood out to you. And we'll kind of use that to close out our Q&A. Anybody want to share a moment from workshop? Surprise, delight, shock, epiphany.
This is around workshop, but I'll just say it's been super exciting to have Lindsay's book published while we're in like Congress with each other.
Yes.
Yeah.
So pretty amazing.
Aw, shucks. This whole thing.
I love the triumphs, right? See what I mean about the kindness, you know, like poets being good to one another. So, all right,
can I jump in?
Yeah, please do.
I think related to that, like hear them actually read their work also has been crucial. I think that what was so important about this, our cohort is that we're a horizontal working group. And so we're all talking about it together. So we're really workshopping these poems and throwing them out there and having readings. And so it was wonderful to hear about other folks, like processes, like some folks are doing multimedia work like Lindsay, and like hearing them read the work and also seeing the visual and then getting to see the book, like that is what's helping me as a writer think about the different ways that we can be writers and poets. And so it's just been incredible to see how different people work, their different inspirations, what they bring to it, their approaches, because it helps us, you know, find different ways to experiment. And so the idea of form and how things are supposed to look, we really abandoned that, like Anastasia said, and, you know, colors and borders and all that. We really did away with that and just put the work out there for one another to read and experience together. And that's been really great.
All right, audience members, we're pretty much out of time, but don't be too sad because the Arts Research Center has two more additional live stream poetry readings. Coming up, then I hope you'll all put on your calendars. In spring semester, we'll celebrate Kundaman, an Asian and Asian American poetry collective, by inviting Kathy Lin Che, Chen Chen, and Jenny Z to the Arts Research Stage on March 10th. And on April 28th, we'll welcome Tarfia Fezula, Vivi Francis, and Matthew Olsman for a Detroit Roots poetry reading. Also, the next Poetry in the Census Fellowship application will open in spring 2022 for the 2022-23 academic year. So in case you or someone you know would like to be a part of this amazing creative program, you can find more information about all of these upcoming poetry opportunities and events and our Flash Poetry Series at the Arts Research Center website, which is arts.berkeley.edu. Before we go, I want to say thanks again to the Poetry and the Senses Fellows for sharing your art and your insights about making. Lindsay, Ahmad, Maurya, Anastasia, Gisselle, Jesse, Vincente, and Damani, thank you so much.
And a big thank you to Lori. Just, she's behind the scenes, but
Lori McNeil, behind the scenes and making all of this magic happen all the time, really quietly. Fierce, beautiful poet, visual artist. Incredible talent and just generous, generous friend as well to all of us, I think.
Yes.
My thanks to the audience for attending this reading live or later on via the event recording. The Arts Research Center is grateful to be in community with you. And finally, a huge thank you again to the Engaging the Senses Foundation for making all of this possible. So hooray for poetry, hooray for poets, hooray for Lori, hooray for Mona. And good night, folks. Thanks so much for coming.
Thank you.